So today we're going to talk about what happens when our integrals head off to infinity. In other words, we have to deal with that. Like, what does it mean when we have things going off to infinity? Well, it can happen in a couple of different ways. Our function could be blowing up. Our bounds could be blowing up. That could lead to something which is quite improper. We call it improper integrals. So anything that has an infinity, that's an improper integral. So let's talk about how we deal with it. So, as we said, look, any integral which involves infinity is improper. And there's lots of ways you can involve infinity. At least there's two general categories that we should be familiar with. And one is vertically. So that says, hey, our function is blowing up. Okay, so we're looking for any place where our function blows up. Now, when we talk about blowing up, we have to be a little bit careful here, because one thing to keep in mind is that when we talk about integrals that are improper, we always mean definite integrals. It has to be a definite integral. So, as an example here, all these integrals we're going to talk about are improper integrals, but you could have an integral such as the following, integral 1 to 2 of 1 over x dx. Is this an improper integral? And the answer is no. This is perfectly fine. This we're happy with. You might say, well, what's going on? Well, what's going on is, look, the function 1 over x does blow up, but not in the place we care about. You see, 1 over x blows up at 0, not between 1 and 2. And so we're okay. All right, so what are some examples of improper integrals where the function blows up? Well, here, notice that 0, you'd have a denominator of 0. Okay, so that's an improper integral. Here, you'd actually have at both negative 1 and 1, you'd have something going off huge. Here, between negative 1 and 1, well, at negative 1 and 1, you're perfectly fine. But it's not just endpoints you have to worry about. You have to worry about what's in the middle. And notice at 0, whoop, uh-oh, trouble, my friend. We've got trouble. All right, well, what else? Anything else? Well, e to the minus x, no, that's a perfectly fine function. 1 over x squared plus 1 doesn't blow up. In fact, the largest it ever gets is 1. 1 over x cubed plus 1, well, that's a little different than 1 over x squared plus 1, because x cubed, if you think about it, if I take a negative cubed, I could get a negative. And so negative 1 cubed plus 1 is 0. Okay, so that blows up at 0. All right. Now, I want to point something out. So you can have a couple of things happening with the vertical asymptote. You could have one endpoint be bad. You could have two endpoints be bad. You can also have a middle point be bad. And of course, you could imagine much more could happen. You could have several points in the middle be bad. So don't just say, I just have to check the ends. Or, once I found one, I found them all. No. You have to make sure you're methodical and you've captured all the behaviors. Okay, so those are the vertical kind. The horizontal kind are easy to spot. Horizontal says what? Well, we care about, do we go off to the infinities? And we have two varieties, right? We have the positive infinity and the negative infinity. So we have to check both. So we say, anything with infinity involved? Okay, so there's an infinity there. These don't involve infinity in the bounds. On the other hand, these ones down here do involve infinity in the bounds. And so you'll see, look, you can have both vertical and horizontal issues where, you know, you have to deal with them. So these are some of the things that we have to be aware of. Make sure you know how to spot an improper integral. Look for bounds with infinity or negative infinity. Look for functions blowing up within the place where we care about. Again, even if our function blows up, but it blows up outside of where we're going, that's not improper. It has to blow up inside the piece we're considering. All right, so now that we have some idea of what improper integrals are, why do we need to do anything and how do we do it? So that's our next concern. So we do have a method for dealing with improper integrals. But before we do that, I just want to point out that there's a reason why we want to deal with improper integrals, which is if we're not careful, we can get to some really wacky and crazy ideas. So look at the integral from negative 1 to 1 of 1 over x squared. Now, if we just naively say, okay, let's just integrate, no problem, we can integrate this, right? It's x to the negative 2, so that's not hard to integrate. We get negative 1 over x, evaluated from negative 1 to 1, because the integral of 1 over x squared is minus 1 over x. Well, if you now plug it in, that's minus 1 over 1, subtract minus 1 over minus 1. Other than the fact that there's a whole bunch of negatives, if you clean it all up, you get negative 2. And at this point, you're like, okay, great. Answer is negative 2, Steve. What's the big deal? Well, the big deal is if you graph the function 1 over x squared, it's looking like this. All right? And so what's happening is the function is never negative. And now we're going from negative 1 to positive 1, and we're saying, look, all this area here, when we find it, the total area is somehow negative 2? How is it that when we find this integral that should have a positive answer, we get a negative answer out? And that's actually a good question. And the problem is we weren't careful. So you have to be careful. If you don't pay attention, you get weird stuff happening. And so the real thing is that this part right here, this is not true. And we have to find a way to deal with improper integrals. All right, so what's the procedure? It's not so bad. Our first step is find the infinities. All right, so we know how to find it. Look in the bounds, look where we have things blowing up. All right, second step, break things into parts. One for each infinity involved. Now you might say, why can't we just do it all at once? And the answer is, strange things can happen. And we've talked about this. We're going to talk about even stranger things that can happen. So we really do want to be careful and say, look, we want to handle each individual part by itself. And say, okay, so for instance here, you would say negative 1 to 0, 0 to 1. And that's what we would do. We say, okay, great, break it up into two pieces. Negative 1 to 0, and 0 to 1. That's an example of what would happen if we did that here. Okay, so that would be step 2. Step 3 says, okay, what we need to do is we need to not do an improper integral. We need to make things proper. And how can we do that? Well, suppose I'll just pick on one of these two pieces. Let's suppose I look at this piece. I say, look, the reason it's improper is the endpoint. So what I want to do is I want to just pull back a little bit from 0. So I'm going from negative 1 to 0. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to just nudge it off 0 a little bit. So I'm just below 0. So what we would look at is the integral negative 1 up to someplace b, where here b is below 0. Now, why does that help us? Well, because now there's like, look, it's the same thing as we've always done. Life is good. Antiderivatives, woohoo, and we're happy. Of course, this is just saying, well, that's if we stop at b. So we went from negative 1 up to b. We really want to say negative 1 up to 0. How do we do that little last little doop, doop, over? Well, now what we do is we just say, start moving b closer to 0. In other words, we're going to take a limit. So that's the next step. Take a limit. See, this helps us solve the issue. What should happen? You see, whenever you have things like infinity involved, then you have to step back and say, okay, we can't really do things that involve infinite processes, but we can't talk about what should happen. And that's what we do. And now, if you do this, and you actually carry it out, what ends up happening is, I'll leave the details to you. This turns out to be negative 1 over x, and you evaluate, so you get negative 1 over b, and then minus 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 1, which is minus 1, and now you let b go to 0 from below, and you say, look, it's negative 1 divided by a very small negative number. That's arbitrarily large. So it heads towards infinity. So that's what's happening to that expression. And now, here's the last piece. Say, look, you're going through it piece by piece by piece, because you had to break it up into pieces. If each part you get a number, great. Add them up and you're done. If even just one part says, it's blowing up, it's infinity or it's negative infinity, then you say, forget it. It diverges. We don't know what it is. If one part blows up, then you can say, well, it blows up to infinity or it blows up to minus infinity. But if one part goes to infinity, one part goes to infinity, then definitely just like forget it. You will never know because it cannot be determined. So that's actually the idea. It's a beautiful idea. And it just says, hey, to handle my problems, I'll break my problems into easier parts. And for each one, I'll say what should happen as I get close to my danger spot, what's causing my things to blow up. One thing to remember as you're doing this, because we have limits involved, don't forget we have this wonderful tool that might be useful, which is L'Hôpital. Oh, L'Hôpital! Oh. And so you can use it. I will say sometimes you really don't need to do a limit, because by the time you go through and you carry out the integration, or maybe after you do a substitution, you might start with something which is improper, but a good substitution will cancel out the improperness, or a nice integration, what the function doesn't have an issue, then you don't need to really do the limit. You just plug it in. But if you still have something going on where it's like hard to determine what it is, then you need to take the limit. And L'Hôpital is a great tool to do that. Okay, one more idea. The last idea we want to talk about is saying, look, sometimes we're happy just to have an answer to the question, is it finite or not? Even if we don't know the answer, you know, can we say whether or not there's a number or whether or not it blows up? And so it becomes useful to start talking about making comparisons. So what does that mean? Well, we have our nice basic fact, which says, look, the integral from a to b of f of x is going to be smaller than the integral from a to b of g of x if f of x is always less than or equal to g of x. Similarly, if g of x is always less than or equal to h of x, then again, we have that this is less than or equal to the integral from a to b of h of x. So we can think of this happening also for improper integrals. We say, okay, look, let's just say maybe I can bound a function below something which I know is finite, or maybe I can found a function below by something which I know is not finite. So here's sort of one possibility just sort of to get the mind going, help build up intuition. We could say, suppose we put here's our function f, and underneath that is another function g. And we're always going to assume here, in this picture, I'm going to assume everything is greater than or equal to zero. It depends on the context as to what you want to assume. Okay, so here's my functions f, g, and h. Now, suppose I knew that the amount of area under f, if I started from, let's say, here's my A, and I said the total area under F, because I can compute that in some way, is finite. Well, if I look at the area under F, and I compare that to the area under G, well, G is smaller, because it's inside. So if I'm finite, and then I do something inside of that, I'm still finite. So that says, look, if the integral from a to infinity of f converges, then that implies, look, it's also true for the integral from a to infinity of g converges, and assuming that, again, pictures are as drawn here. All right, well, we can also go the other direction. Suppose h of x, this part, suppose we knew that had infinite area. In other words, when we integrated, we had an infinite total. Well, what about g? Well, g is h plus more. So that says what? Well, that says in the other direction, if the integral from a to infinity of h diverges, then really we know that the integral from a to infinity of h also diverges. So we can talk about making comparisons. And one of the things that you want to do in making comparisons is get a sense, do I want to compare something below it or something above it? If I think something converges, I want to put it below something which I know converges. If I think something diverges, I want to put it above something which I know diverges. And then I can make conclusions about whether it converges or diverges. Now, there is actually a very nice idea. So this is more or less what we talked about right now is comparison. There's this another notion which is called limit comparison, which says, hey, look at the limit of the ratio of f over g, and suppose that goes to L. Well, what does that really mean? Well, if f of x over g of x goes to L, what you have is that f of x over g of x is between some L plus a little bit and L minus a little bit. Or you could say, hey, f is less than some multiple of g and bigger than some multiple of g. That's what you're really saying. So if the ratio of the two functions converges to some number, as long as it's a positive number, it doesn't matter what that positive number is, it really says that they act like multiples of one another. And now we say, aha, we can pull out our comparison test and say, look, if one of them converges, say f converges, then this smaller piece also converges. Well, it's a constant times g, so g converges. If f diverges, this larger piece, which is a constant times g, also diverges. So that when we have that the two functions, they behave the same. That's what we mean when we say the limit of their ratio goes to L. Then they either both converge or both diverge. So we're tying things together. Now, why is this nice? Well, what you can do is you can say, focus on the important parts. In other words, what's driving the growth? And if you have the function, you say, okay, you know, maybe like you have an x squared plus x downstairs. X squared can drive the growth of the denominator as we get really large. We say, okay, good. Then x squared is what we're going to really be comparing. We can get rid of this sort of extra noise. And we're going to do this a lot more in the future. We're going to be getting into future topics where we dig into this. But this notion of limit comparison is really saying, hey, let's try to understand what's happening. Let's focus on the growth, and let's focus on saying what's the true behavior. We'll see this as we go through some examples. Speaking of examples, I think now is a great time for us to transition and start working on some problems. So, see you soon.